Good afternoon and very welcome. We are very happy to host for you today this first edition of the Deloitte Human Capital Trends event webinar. And this first webinar will be centered around people data and people analytics. And we are your hosts for today. My name is Frederike Rip. I'm a senior manager in talent strategy and analytics within Deloitte Human Capital. And next to me,
my name is Sander Buijsrogge. I'm a manager in the People Analytics Department of the Deloitte Human Capital Group.
And my name is Sachiel Dervey. I'm not a consultant. I work within Deloitte Legal. And within Deloitte Legal, I'm responsible for the employment law team. And we regularly also deal with employment law and privacy related issues.
Thank you, Sachiel. Thank you, Sander. Well, each year, our Center of Expertise at Deloitte conducts a human capital trends survey. And this year, we've had almost more than 11,000 respondents on this human capital trends survey. And the purpose of it is to identify amongst HR leaders and business leaders what are the main trends within human capital worldwide. And we've had respondents from over more than 124 countries, equally split between business leaders and HR leaders. We've been conducting this survey for the past 8 years now, and we are very excited that we have received so many respondents this year. This is incredible, also because we want to make sure that the business voice is heard, and that has happened in this survey as well. Yeah, so what are the trends that we have seen in this year's survey? What we are seeing is an increased pressure on the organizational environment. Increased pressure on the organizational environment. And there's a lot of pressure from external organizations on companies to better act in society as a whole. And in there, we have identified three macro trends. And the first macro trends that we have identified is the power of the individual. And what we're seeing is that there's increasing pressure on organizations. And 86 of organizations have indicated that there's an increased pressure to do more for the individual, especially due to the amount of millennials that is present these days in organization. And that also has consequences for people data, and people data can play a big role in that macro trend. The second macro development that we are seeing is that businesses are being expected to fill a wider leadership gap in society. So there's increased pressures on organizations to act more sustainable and to be more responsible towards their employees. And also that is an important macro trend in the Human Capital Trends report. And the third important macro trend that we are seeing is the technological change, which is having unforeseen impacts on society. And creates massive opportunities also due to the increase of technology, but also is putting pressure on companies. Because a lot of data is generated, and how to use this data in a good way. In total, we have the three macro trends that are divided into the three themes that I just mentioned, and from there, 10 main trends and subtrends result that we are going to talk around in our next webinar. Series of webinars. The first one is the workforce ecosystem. The second one is new rewards. The third one is careers to experiences. Those are the three subtrends that relate to the increasing power of the individual. The second one, macro trend, is filling society's leadership gap. And the three subtrends of those are the longevity dividend, citizenship and social impact, and well-being. And the third macro trend, leveraging technology for sustainable growth, has also three subtrends, which are AI, robotics and automation, the hyper-connected workforce, and people data. And people data will be the topic of this webinar today. So what are we seeing in the hierarchy of trends is that people data has been identified by 85% of business leaders and HR leaders to be the second largest important trend today. And in the Netherlands, it has even been scored the first important trend. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit more in this webinar. So what has been identified about people data and what are the upcoming trends there, Sander?
So what we see when we look at the outcomes of the trend, the people data trend, we see a clear division between two major topics. The first one is focused on the risks that people data and the use of people data can bring to the organization and especially to the consumer brand. Facebook is a really good example right now where we see that when the Cambridge Analytica scandal broke out, that their shareholder value plummeted and there was a big uproar in society. And this is really showing that today's society doesn't accept it anymore when your data is just used without your consent or is used in a wrong way, and it can really hurt your brand. Equally, organizations are now scared that this will happen to them and to their brand from that in the same way as it happened to Facebook. So it really shows that you have to really be sensitive to the sentiments that live with your customers, but also your employees and the broader society. The second trend is driven by the technological aspect. So as more and more data becomes available within different systems, organizations have the drive to make more use of that data. And the first thing they need to do is to integrate the data that comes from different systems before they can really start using it to gather the required insights. So those are the two main trends that will also be the topic of our webinar today. When we look at the first trend, we see that 25% of our respondents are scared that using people data will impact their consumer brand or is worried about the risks that it brings. That 64% is responded that they're actually actively managing the liabilities that that are associated with using people data. Then, if we go to the second trend, we see that 69% of the respondents are currently looking at how they are going to integrate the data from all the systems. That explains how the market is reacting to this trend. We can go to the next one.
Yeah, so the next topic that is linked to this is, of course, the GDPR, which is the new legislation within Europe, which has a big impact on organizations. And organizations are worrying also about how is this impacting my use of people data within my organization. And how should I use GDPR and work with GDPR? And Sashil, you are going to tell us a little bit more on the GDPR and the consequences for the use of people data within organizations. And before we go to your piece, I'd like to stress that if you have any questions for us, please put them in the chat box. And we, at the end of the session, have some time to answer these questions. So feel free to put your questions in the chat box and we will answer them later. Sashil.
Maybe from a GDPR point of view, it's interesting to stress that the Human Capital Trends Report comes out every year. And over the past 5 years, we've seen that the trend was called people analytics. indicating that organizations were really focused on already gathering insights based on the people data and trying to really develop this this part in the, within their organization. I think what's really telling is that this year the trend is no longer called people analytics, but the trend is called people data. And that really stresses that organizations now realize that the people data underlying all these analytics that they really want to do and the value they want to drive within their organizations using people analytics starts off with the people data. And that it's no longer just that they understand that the value also for the employee themselves, how their data is being used, how their data is being managed, how their data needs to be protected, suddenly becomes then an important topic when you dive down to that basic level. So without further ado, we're diving into how, from a legal point of view, this is being managed.
Yeah, thank you. GDPR, a hot topic in the market. A lot of people are getting tired of it, but unfortunately we have to deal with it for quite some time, I'm afraid. Very hot topic. We've seen it in the media a lot of media coverage around the GDPR. The first thing I want to stress is that don't panic. We've put that on the slide as well. Don't panic because please be aware that the key concepts in the GDPR are not brand new, are not totally different than the legal framework we have seen, that we knew before the GDPR was introduced. But yes, it is true that GDPR privacy, data privacy, is high on the agenda. It's becoming more and more important. So it is something to keep in mind, to pay close attention to, be aware of the impact of GDPR because of the impact it can have. Although big part of the legal framework is the same, there are of course some important changes. What you see is that there is much more focus on transparency. So it's important to put more emphasis on how information is gathered, what you do with the data. So you must inform the data subject or the employee in this respect, what data you are processing for which purposes and how long you will retain that data. Second thing is what we see is the extended rights for data subjects. They have more rights than they had before. I will get back to that a little bit later. And what you also see is that some new legal concepts are introduced, such as privacy by design, meaning that if you start with a project or preparing a service or you build an app, as of the start you should be aware and take into account privacy data protection. And furthermore, privacy by default is also a relevant concept, which actually means that you must take technical and organizational measures to ensure that by default data privacy is taken seriously and that data is only processed in accordance with the specific purpose you are processing it for.
So it takes a lot more preparation, in doing a project.
Yeah, exactly. So in the development phase of every project that includes people data, you should have a specific awareness for data privacy and think about how you are coping with the GDPR rules and how you are going to ensure that you comply with the GDPR as much as possible. Yeah,
yeah. And you also need to put in a lot of documentation, right?
Yeah.
To document all your...
Yeah, you have this obligation to have your internal register. So you must... and that's very interesting to see because many companies, or all companies, process a lot of personal data. But they, before GDPR, they weren't really aware of what they were doing and for what purposes and where the data was stored. And now you see that companies are forced to have a good look at it and make sure that that's laid out also in a register. Mm-hmm. So if you get a visit from the supervising authority, you should be able to show them, listen, this is the data I'm processing for these purposes, etc., etc. So mm-hmm. it requires a lot more work on the front end. That's true.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and in addition, and that's also, of course, something we have all seen in the news a lot, the most important change is, of course, the huge fines that that are put in place for violations of data protection rules. And these fines can go up to 4% of the worldwide turnover of a company, or 20 million euros. So these are considerable amounts, and this is really the major change if you compare it to the old legislation. So let me now touch upon some of the key elements of data processing, how it should be done and how it should not be done. Well, first of all, data must be processed in a lawful, proportional and necessary way. And basically that means use common sense. Use only the data you need for the specific purpose you are pursuing. And always try to see if you can do it with less data than you maybe would anticipate beforehand. So be aware of it. Furthermore, you must always have a legitimate ground for data processing. You can see them on the slides, a couple of examples. Consent is one of them. But be aware that the provision of consent by an employee in an employer-employee relation is difficult. It was mentioned in a report that actually in this relationship where there's a disbalance between the power you have, the employer is a strong, mm-hmm. strong party, and the employer is dependent on the employer. So that's why it's difficult to rely upon this consent ground in employment relations in most of the cases. So be aware of that. Of course, and a good example is if you have an employment agreement, you must process personal data. People want to get paid, so they want to get their salary in their bank account. So that data you need to process in order to execute the employment contract. So that would indeed give a legitimate ground to process. And I think also in practice, a very important ground is the legitimate interest that a company may have to process data. And there you always must balance that against the breach or the privacy rights of the employee. So the more breach you have towards those privacy of the employee, the less, the more difficult it will be to process based on this legitimate interest. So you must always balance the interests of the employer on the one hand and the employee on the other hand.
And Sashil, is there any impact on the data that HR is already capturing about employees, like for example performance data, or because that's
could be. I think there is an important issue if you look at the retention of personal data. Mm-hmm. So one of the elements that follows from GDPR is that you should not retain personal data longer than is necessary for the specific purpose. And if you look honestly in most of the many HR environments, I think that this is not, it wasn't the focus area before GDPR, mm-hmm. that's for sure. So I do see that a lot of companies are really working on it right now, putting in place policies. Mm-hmm. But it's difficult because if I look at my own practice, I have an inbox and I have many emails, a lot of emails, and I have a lot of employment agreements and I have a lot of salary slips of employees we were advising on. So we are also working now on putting in place guidelines to delete those data after some time, after the files closed. Mm-hmm. And the same would apply, of course, within the HR environment itself. So yes, that's something to keep in mind. How long will you retain data?
Yeah. Okay.
Extra attention for sensitive personal data. So that means data about someone's race, health, sexual preferences, membership of trade unions. The general rule is that you cannot process that data unless you comply with one of the exceptions that is laid out in the GDPR. Like I already mentioned, that transparency is becoming much more important towards the employees. We had an example the other day of one of our clients that was that had a kind of employment conflict with one of the employees, and it was about subject A, but the employee decided to add a subject B, being, hey, listen, we have GDPR, could you please provide me with an overview of all the data you process of me? that company was in the process of building their processes and making that visible what they were actually doing. But that's a clear example where you see that, and that's maybe a trend that we can see in the future, especially if it's if parties are in a conflict, that employees may use the GDPR as an additional stick to hit the employer and to make it difficult. And so that's something to keep in mind.
So how long do employers have to provide such an overview?
They should do so in 1 month.
1 month?
Yeah, 1 month. It can be extended to 3 months, but that's for exceptional situations, but the general guideline is 1 month. So that's that means that you should have your act together and that you should be able to respond relatively quickly.
Yeah. Interesting.
Okay, finally about this slide, I mentioned it before that the data subjects have various rights. So they have the right to access their data, like the example I just mentioned. They can ask rectification of data if it's not correct. They can object to the processing, etc., etc. So and those rights have really become stronger for the employee. A final slide from my side in this part about GDPR and people data. People data, people analytics, a few takeaways. Like I said, it's very important to have a clear view of why people data is processed and for what purposes. So companies should think why they are doing what they are doing, what's the vision behind it, what's the strategy behind it. And they should make sure that the data they collect is in line with that purpose. An example, if you guys do an analysis of the well-being in a specific company or in a specific department of the company, you should ask yourself the question, okay, is it necessary to have the names of the employees if you do a survey? Is it necessary to have their email addresses? I cannot say upfront yes or no, but it's something to keep in mind and to be aware if you work in these projects. A lot of the things you do are done through technical means. Mm-hmm. So you must put in place technical measures to safeguard and protect data. We've talked about retention period. So if you have done an analysis of well-being within your company, you should think, how long should I keep that data? If you have extracted the conclusions from the data, it's quite fair to say that after that you can delete the underlying data. So those are things to take into account and to consider. And also to think about, okay, do I really need to process personal data for this purpose? Because maybe mm-hmm. you could, if you only use anonymized data, mm-hmm. Which is not covered by the GDPR, it would save you a lot of hassle, GDPR mm-hmm. hassle, mm-hmm. And then you could still do the thing you need to do, make that analysis based on that anonymized data. So mm-hmm. those are things to keep in mind if we are talking about people data and GDPR.
Yeah, I think we are doing that more and more, or as much as possible to use anonymized data indeed. I think one of the things that is sometimes difficult is that even if you have anonymized data, it's sometimes still possible, to track and trace the person, what the data is about. For example, if a department only consists of one or two or three persons, and there's only one female in the department, that makes it difficult.
That's true. And then you cannot speak about anonymized data, because anonymized data means that you are absolutely not able to trace it back to an individual. Mm-hmm. For example, if you have two files, one is anonymized, but you have access to another file, which if you put them together, you can easily see, okay, this is Sander, this is Frederike, then you're not talking about anonymous data. So that's important to keep in mind. Yeah. But it even if you are able to connect it, the fact that that connection is maybe difficult or that there are different people involved is a good measure to make sure that you have such that you process as least data as you need for your purpose.
Okay,
that's great. So thanks, Cecile. So what we see in the trend is that GDPR, or what we see in the market, that GDPR is often viewed as many legislation is, as something that's really restricting organizations to work the way they want to do, right? So often there's this feeling that GDPR is bad, or you know, it's perceived as overall negative. But we really want to stress that GDPR, from my point of view at least, can also be seen as a really great opportunity. The first opportunity is also given the context that many organizations are in now, that GDPR actually creates the need to develop a collaborative culture between organizations and their employees. So there's no longer only focusing on the data or the advantages that organizations get by using data with regards to their profit margins, because you know employees will not just sign off on yes, use my data to only increase my productivity. And that really brings me to my second point, is that GDPR is really providing organizations, or forcing organizations almost, to really have that strong focus on what are we going to use this data for. And no longer can that only be focused on profit, but it has to be focused on the individual, because the individual eventually needs to sign off or can object to using their personal data for only increasing profit. So what you see is that organizations really now need to strike a balance between making life better for the employee in general, and through that trying to increase their profit margin or their profits in general. So so that's also why GDPR is an opportunity.
So this comes back to the trend of the power of the individual, right?
Yes, definitely. And also to the societal impact that individual these days expect that organizations make. Mm-hmm. And with society, I also mean the role that the organization plays within the society that we live in. So also as an employer. Mm-hmm. And that's why you see that nowadays the topics that organizations want to use their data for are all focused mainly on making life for the employee much better. So you see that large organizations really start to focus on the employee experience and how data can really give them the insight where that experience can be enhanced. Mm-hmm. So that one day to the next, an employee comes to work and suddenly feels that a specific part of their job or the services that an employer offers, think about learnings or these things, have been enhanced dramatically, mm-hmm. and leading to maybe that employee wanting to stay longer and thereby increasing the revenue. So you see that data, in that respect, brings focus to these positive topics. Other topics that we see in the market a lot are employee engagement. So how can we keep these employees more engaged? What if engagement drops? Usually you see large groups of people leave the organization, and that's not what you like as an employer, obviously, because a lot of intellect leaves with it as well. So really focusing on how can we make that part of the experience better is very much important. Well-being is another trend that we see also, and there will be a webinar on well-being as well, is also a big topic. I think from a GDPR and data point of view, the interest is about the sensitivity of the data that's being used there. However, the impact of being able to really improve your well-being practices through using data, the impact that it has on employees is tremendous. So that's why I think a lot of organizations are also focusing on that. As said, we see that people data has a lot of impact on several of the other key trends as well. Think about the rewards. Nowadays, employees really value more personalized rewards. that goes beyond just monetary rewards. So really using data to identify what the impact is of various types of rewards on, for instance, the engagement or on the way that your employees look at you as an employer is a very big topic. Again, there will be a webinar on this.
Yeah.
Well-being, as said, I think those are two great examples of what other trends data from that point of view is very important in. So let me then dive into the next bit on people data. It's really about people data maturity. So remember in the beginning we said the trend exists of two bits. It's really about how data is managed, is protected, and is used in relation to the individual. And the second part of the trend is really about how, as an organization, you can get all that data together, because traditionally the HR data landscape is often very scattered. And now what you over the past few years we have seen a lot of organizations investing in HRIS technology, also already improving that the coherence between the data landscape, but still you see that the connection with other systems that are already in the organization, other platforms, many of these HR systems were not designed from the start to integrate all this data. So really integrating it from many other systems within the organizational landscape is now a challenge. And we see that 70% of the organizations are currently busy trying to integrate all that data and also integrate it into their decision making. And only 10% is very ready to deal with these challenges and also thinking about protecting their data, because with all the new and shiny systems there's suddenly a lot of technology in front of you and you just have to it's not the end there. But then as an employer or as an organization you need to make sure that all this this data is well used and well protected. So within Deloitte, we use the analytics maturity model to really identify where organizations are in the use of people data and in performing analytics. And what we see is that integrating data and creating integrated data landscapes is very important in the lower levels, in the level one and level two, because that's the basis of whatever you would like to achieve when growing in your analytics maturity. And we also see that in another study that most organizations are now in level two, meaning that they're really trying to integrating these data systems. And that's being echoed by this report. So we're finding the same things in different studies.
And I think the top companies, the most mature companies are farther, right?
Yes, so the further you want to grow throughout the analytics maturity model, it's really about having the basics right. So already having these integrated systems and already also developing other types of capabilities. And in order to grow these capabilities in Deloitte research, we have identified the six key factors that help organizations develop in this people analytics maturity. And interestingly, the two that are coming back in this trend, meaning data governance and core data infrastructure, are already two out of six trends, two out of six factors that help you drive this maturity or maturing. So that's interesting, and I think also from a future perspective, that maybe in the next years, or likely in the next years, we will see those other four key factors, such as creating a data culture or increasing the overall data literacy within your organization, to become more to the forefront when it comes to the trends.
And Sander, do you think that this whole trend around GDPR and the increasing pressure on making data being more responsible about your people data. Do you think that will be a bottleneck for organizations to mature further in the people analytics maturity level? Or
no, definitely not. I think if it's one thing, then it's that GDPR really structures it for organizations. So where we used to see a lot of organizations are coming to us saying, hey, we have this whole lot of data and now we want to get something out of it. That used to be the other way around. And also the value that was created by these organizations consisted of luck more than focus. So GDPR now really brings that focus. Organizations now need to really consider what do we want to do, what data do we need for that, and also start that conversation with their employees on, hey, we really want to do this for you. So I think the whole climate will change from top down to more collaborative focus. And I think in a whole, that will really engage your employees as well. To really help drive this maturity and maturing of your analytics capabilities.
Well, that's great.
Yes, yeah. Yes it is. So we're nearing the end of at least the part that we would like to tell the audience. But before we go, we want to dive into the next step. So what can you as a practitioner or an organization, what can you do right now? What can you start right now to really focus on the people data and maturing the people data governance and also the GDPR? So from my point of view, I think the first thing that organizations need to do also from the external pressure point of view is to start listening carefully to your external as well as your internal environment. So really start designing processes that link you as an HR organization to the voice of your employee and really start understanding what are their needs, what are their expectations, how are they being met or not being met. And this listening can be done in several ways, direct, indirect. So really build up your listening capabilities. The second one is really closely related to the trend I just discussed. So it's really about building that the internal definitions that you are using within HR. You often see, for instance, HR and finance using different definitions about same KPIs, for instance. So really align these definitions and metrics because that will greatly enhance how different departments can work together. And then invest in tools and technology to help integrate the different types of data and the different systems. The last one is already looking a little bit ahead to the future, thinking about actively managing how HR leaders are linking their HR activities towards business outcomes. So really think about what changes are you making within your HR processes or what initiatives are you taking to achieve a certain outcome, and already think about what are the key data points that underlie this so we can track the impact that's being made through these initiatives. So that's from the people data and analytics point of view, from a GDPR point of view.
Yeah, from we have discussed a lot about GDPR already, so I don't want to repeat things. But I think for now it's really important for companies to make sure that they understand what they do, what data they have, for what purposes, and more specifically if it's about a specific project or a specific request to do a kind of analysis. Be aware of your purpose and make sure that the data is in line with that. Like we discussed before, it's also important for companies to be aware what kind of data they transfer to third parties, and Deloitte could be such a third party. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a responsibility on both sides, on the side of our clients, to think, okay, what data do we really need to get to Deloitte to do their analysis, and also for us to be critical about, okay, you are giving us now this big Excel sheet with all these data, but we do not really need all that. So be aware of what you transfer to third parties. We haven't discussed yet international data transfers. So if data goes from one country to another country, it's really something to keep in mind. In principle, within the EU, we have this kind of free movement of personal data because all the EU's countries are governed by the same regulation, the GDPR. But if you go to transfer data to outside the EU, you should be aware because there could be strict limitations and you should see and decide how you could do that. Furthermore, in some cases you would have to do this data protection impact assessment. And that's when you are processing data which is likely to result in a kind of high risk of high risk to the rights and freedoms of the data subjects. So if it's maybe not sensitive in the definition of the GDPR, but if it's more deeper info of about the data subjects and may impact their private rights, then you should do this data protection impact assessment beforehand. And finally, I haven't mentioned that before, but please be aware also that this topics is something you should discuss with your works council.
Yep.
I think you should put it on the agenda to discuss GDPR, how you as a company are dealing with it and what you're doing to make sure you're compliant.
Yep.
But also more specifically, if you put in place a specific regulation that is about the processing of personal data, or if you amend such a policy because of the GDPR, you should involve your works council. And I've been talking to clients about this topic, GDPR, and always mention this works council topic. And most companies say, oh, it's good that you say that because I didn't realize it. So that's something, a takeaway to...
And I think also from that point, already starting the conversation right now on how to implement the GDPR and how to work in the future with Works Council, starting that conversation with them now can only help you in the future, both on the expectation bit, so you both understand as an employer, as an organization, as a works council, where do you fit in? What's expected? What's your role? And then second of all, when you're actually going to work with the data, or you're going to process it, analyze it, and you're going to run a people analytics project, then the works council is already understanding of your goals and has no hesitation of also working with you to drive that project and to bring in their views and their value rather than just being the bad
exactly.
cop.
No, I fully agree. But to avoid misunderstanding, if you are going to implement such a specific project, it may not be necessary to ask prior approval of the Works Council to do so. So it's really about policies, about the processing of personal data that you should do with the approval and in the process with the Works Council. But I fully agree that also transparency in this respect, not only to the individual, but also to your Works Council. Make them part of this topic, involve them, inform them, and that will help you to get understanding also maybe to the individual employees. At the end,
Exactly. Great.
Okay. Well, thanks, Sashil. Thanks, Sander. We're now going over to the questions and answers. So we're curious what your questions have been based on the session. And the first question is that you have asked is: are organizations ready for GDPR?
Are they, or should they be ready?
They should be.
They should be. Right.
That's for sure. To be honest, I don't think that all companies are fully ready for GDPR at this moment, but what we do see is that a lot of companies have this on the agenda, are really working on it. I gave the examples of a client, some clients we have, they are really big Excel sheets with all the data processing which is there. So yes, a lot of companies are working on it, but if whether all the companies are fully GDPR compliant at this moment, I don't think so. But we do see that it has a lot of attention. It's on the agenda, and that's good. And if, mm-hmm. if you're not have not started yet, mm-hmm. then it's really time to get started. Because last week there was this press release from the supervising authority in the Netherlands. They received in the first month around 600 complaints from individuals about data protection violations. Mainly relating to not being able to get information about what data is processed about them, but also requests to delete their personal data is really difficult, so it appears. In my own experience, every time at evening I go to dinner, I get these irritating calls about people wanting to sell you things. I've put my email address many times in this specific register, but it's apparently not working, and those things are really not okay for a lot of companies, I would think. So,
So what are the consequences? That's a nice next question. What are the consequences of an organization that does not have its GDPR process organized?
Yeah. Well, like I mentioned in the beginning, these huge fines are introduced, of course, and that should really be a stick to make sure that you comply. We do not know yet how these fines will be imposed and what the amounts will be. But I think the figures I mentioned in itself are reason enough to make sure that you're compliant. So that's the financial part. Yeah. But I think, and that touches upon what you mentioned before, Sander, is that also the image to you, to the brand of the company, to the company itself. You want to prevent that you are the first company mentioned on the headlines of the newspapers saying that you're in gross violation of the GDPR. So that's not a financial thing, but more an image issue. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And how is it checked if organizations comply with the GDPR?
Well, the supervising authority is allowed to come to the organization and do an investigation. So that is a possibility that they simply come and ask you, okay, what have you been doing? Have you put this in place? Have you put that in place? Mm-hmm. And based on that investigation, fines could be imposed. Mm-hmm. And that investigation is likely to happen if there have been several complaints about specific topic. That's what I would expect. And also looking at the fact that the supervising authority still is lacking enough resources, they will probably go after those companies first.
There's no guarantee there.
No.
So, Gilles, do employees also have obligations? Do employees also have obligations with regards to GDPR?
Yes, because we ourselves are also employees. Mm-hmm. So, and we have been trained by our employer about the GDPR. Mm-hmm. We have all done this e-learning to create awareness of the regulations, how we should act in specific situations. Mm-hmm. We have had discussions in our internal teams how to deal with personal data. I refer to the emails we all had in our systems with salary slips, etc. So yes, also employees have obligations in that respect, but it's up to the employer to make sure that they are aware of it and that they should know how to act. So it is of course the company that should comply with. But if all the employees do things in the wrong way and violate GDPR, then it will, of course, reflect on the employer. Yeah.
Okay.
Some other questions here. Where is the people analytics capability organized within companies? I propose that I take the question. So that's a fairly interesting question, because it really depends on the overall organization of your own company. In setting up this people analytics capability, you need to consider some key factors there, like are we big enough to centralize some analytics capabilities, or is it dispersed around the organization? Do we maybe already have a large general analytics body within our organization from which we can leverage some knowledge? Or are we just a small company, and do we have to maybe just centralize it with one or two people? So usually what we advise organizations is when you want to start with people analytics, or if you want to mature in that sense, really look at the target operating model, both of your HR, but mainly specifically of your people analytics function. So how are they going to be positioned? Who are they interacting with? What are the processes of the studies or the activities that they're going to do? So many of these questions are answered when you really design a target operating model for your people analytics function. And that's really vital, because what we see in the past few years is that many organizations just start off with some studies and think that really brings the value. But many of these organizations we've seen get stuck in maturing. They don't get enough traction in the business and traction within their organization. And so what we see, the success stories that we have so far really started off with outlining this target operating model for your people analytics function, and really set this up together with a really impactful proof of concept that shows that that really tests the design of your target operating model. And that's only when you gain traction. So there's no one right answer there. It really depends on how your organization is or how your company is organized in the basics. And really, if you want to answer that question, look at the whole target operating model.
And it also, I think, depends on your maturity and also on the skills of the people that you have in your organization. Mm-hmm. And that ties into the next question. That is basically, what kind of skills are necessary to handle people data in this case?
Yeah. So I think obviously, if you're handling data, then and this is the last question. I've just been informed.
Yeah.
The four last. I still have to mention one thing. So it's really when you handle the people data, obviously there's some you wouldn't expect, but there's the legal aspect. So you have to understand how data needs to be handled, protected, used, and all these aspects. Obviously, you have to have some really smart data analysts in there that understand how to create data warehouse, data lakes, and model this. If you look at it from a broader point of view, so if you really want to use people data, then it's really important that you also have people that can work with the business. So when you look at analytics, it's not just running the algorithm, it's really about creating this whole process in which the business is involved and the data guys are involved, and the outcomes really make an impact there.
Yeah, so it's basically a broad mix of skills that is necessary to make people analytics and people data successful.
Exactly, depending on the role that you have within the team. Yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely. So it's a broad question there. This was the last question, although there was one question: will we post these slides? The answer is yes. And the whole webinar will be uploaded, so you can watch it again. Please do that.
Well, thank you everybody for joining us today.
One more thing, there's a next webinar.
Yes, there's a next webinar.
Nice.
And that will be held on August the 30th between 12 and 1 o'clock in the afternoon. It's hosted by our colleagues Sarah Rogers and Jasmijn Koets. And the topic for this webinar will be the workforce ecosystem and the hyper-connected workforce, which also ties into the larger theme within that we are working on as Deloitte of the future of work. So it would be great to have you and your organization joining us then again. It was great having you today.
Yeah.
Sander, thank you very much for joining.
Yeah.
Sashil, thank you very much, and our team in the background, of course, that has helped us organize this. And it was great having you. Looking forward to talk to you again. Thanks a lot.
Bye-bye.
Have a nice afternoon.
Bye.